Good evening. I'm Rabbi Joshua Davidson, and on behalf of Temple Emanu-El, our Skirball Center, and its director, Dr. Gadi Levy, it is my privilege to welcome you to this evening's important program. Tonight, we should acknowledge, is the 77th anniversary of Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass, a coordinated assault on the Jews of the German Reich. Thousands of synagogues, shops, and homes were destroyed or set on fire that night. 100 Jews were killed and hundreds more injured. At least 30,000 were arrested and sent to the death camps. One survivor of the Shoah was Hedy Epstein. Just over a year ago, Ms. Epstein, her Holocaust experiences still alive and at work within her, ascended the stage at a gathering in St. Louis as part of a weekend of demonstrations following the verdict in the death of Michael Brown. Ms. Epstein spoke that night of how, on arriving in the United States in 1948, she was stunned by Southern racism. 66 years later, she was among those arrested protesting the handling of the Brown shooting. "I'm Jewish and I was born in Germany," she told reporters, "so I think I can understand what it feels like to be African American in this country. I remember feeling uncomfortable walking down the street, seeing people cross to the other side. Racism is alive and well in the United States. The power structure that looks at anyone who's different as the other, as less worthy, treats you as if you're less than human." She knew what we know. Anti-Semitism and racism emanate from the same pathology, the failure to discern in those who are different a common humanity. That is why Black Lives Matter is a Jewish issue. The rabbis understood. Asking why the Torah does not open with our beginnings as a nation and the covenant at Sinai, or with our origins as a people and the covenant with Abraham, they answer that the Torah reaches back to creation to teach us about ourselves. God fashioned us from the same first person, Adam, to remind us that we are all brothers and sisters. Therefore, no one should ever say to another, "My lineage is greater than yours." They even taught that the angels in heaven directed God to make Adam with bits of clay from all over the earth so that none should ever say, "My ethnicity is greater than yours," and that the clay should be a varying shade so that none could say, "My color is superior to yours." As Jews, we believe that the same divine spark that animated the first human being burns in us all. That is why Black Lives Matter is a Jewish issue. When the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, he admonished us that sooner or later, all the people of the world will have to discover a way to live together in peace and thereby transform this pending cosmic elegy into a creative psalm of brotherhood. And he believed houses of worship to be uniquely positioned to penetrate at least some of society's racial and ethnic barriers. That is why Black Lives Matter is a Jewish issue. And that is why Temple Emanu-El and our Skirball Center felt compelled to host tonight's program. We do so in partnership with Bend the Ark, a Jewish partnership for justice. Tonight, we welcome very wonderful guests and to introduce them and moderate our conversation about why Black Lives Matter is a Jewish issue. It's my privilege to introduce Stosh Cotler. Stosh is the chief executive officer of Bend the Ark and has 20 years of leadership experience as an educator, trainer, and organizer within social and economic justice movements. The Jewish Daily Forward featured Ms. Cotler in the publication's 14 Jewish Women to Watch in 2014, and again in the annual Forward 50 list of American Jews who have had the most impact on the national conversation. The Center for American Progress, a progressive public policy research and advocacy organization, included Stosh on their list of the 15 progressive faith leaders and groups to watch in 2015 as they work to bring about enduring change. Prior to becoming CEO, Ms. Cotler served as Bend the Arc's Executive Vice President, overseeing some of the organization's most successful national growth strategies, including strategic mergers and affiliations. Prior to joining the organization in 2005, she was the founder and director of an anti-violence organization for women and youth. Stosh, it's my privilege to welcome you and to turn the evening over to you.
Thank you so much, Rabbi. I think you got the unedited version of my bio. That was very long. Welcome, everyone, and thank you so much to the Temple Emanu-El Skirball Center for co-hosting this event with us. And I want to especially thank Dr. Levy and Erica Resnick for your partnership in this event. And I have the incredible honor of serving as Bend the Arc's CEO. We are our country's leading national Jewish organization that focuses exclusively on domestic public policy. We train leaders, we organize Jews across the country to be working in multiracial, multi-faith, multi-class coalitions, and we advocate at the federal, state, and local levels. The issues that we feel passionate about are the same issues that our community, as a majority, feels and cares deeply about, including voting rights, LGBT equality, economic inequality, racial injustice, immigration, and more. And tonight, we are just so thrilled to have this conversation with Opal Tometi, David Goodman, and soon, this is not the seat of Elijah, but Yavilah McCoy, who's joining us. She was on a train from Boston that was running late, so she will be literally making a dramatic entrance at any moment, and we will warmly welcome her onto the stage. So this is just a critical conversation for our community, and I know it's one that has been happening for now the last year and a half, almost 2 years. And I want to share a little story first to talk about why this feels like such a burning and urgent issue. Bend the Arc, a couple of years ago, had the privilege of speaking at the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington. And so this was the anniversary of the march where tens of thousands of people gathered in 1963. It was one of the pinnacle moments in the civil rights movement. It was when Dr. King gave his very famous I Have a Dream speech. It's also the same moment that, directly before Dr. King spoke, Rabbi Joachim Prince gave an incredible speech as well. And it was a time when the Jewish community was both intimately and visibly involved in the civil rights movement, as well as behind the scenes. And it, of course, is also a time where the Jewish community holds a lot of mythology around the role our community did and didn't play. When we spoke a couple of years ago, it was when my predecessor, Alan Van Capel, was CEO, and he was walking down the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, and he was gently touched on the shoulder by an older African-American woman who was not Jewish, and she looked him in the eye, and she smiled at him, and she said, "Thank you. I didn't think the Jewish community still cared," which is crushing, I think. And so I raise this example up for three reasons. One, because we are now in a moment where the Jewish community has been part of every significant social justice struggle that has come down since our community came to this country in large numbers as immigrants, whether it's labor rights or suffrage or civil rights or women's rights. Jews and the Jewish community were visible and present. And suddenly now we are no longer seen on the front lines of social change. I think that's a big problem, and I know that many of you here tonight also think it's a problem, and that's why you're here. And at the same time, I share that story because we know that individual Jews still show up in disproportionate numbers in every social justice struggle that there is currently. And we know, in fact, that the Jewish community's views on all of the issues that we have traditionally cared about haven't changed practically at all. We're still one of the most liberal communities. And yet, even though individual Jews are showing up, we are often not showing up with our public Jewish hat on, and we're not always showing up in a Jewish organization doing the work. So just let me ask, how many of you in the last, let's just say, 12 months have done some kind of action that you would consider social change or social justice? Okay, so that's a lot. And now, how many of you have taken some kind of action this year around racial justice? Okay, also a lot. And how many of you have taken that action on racial justice explicitly as a Jew in a visible way so that everyone knew you were doing it because you were Jewish? Okay, I still have to say that's a lot. but we're probably a skewed audience too. If we were to do that with all the Jews in the country, we would probably see a smaller and smaller number. So maybe this wasn't the right point to bring up here, but you get my point, ultimately. And so that's the second reason I bring up the story. The third is because we now, as a community, are using images of the civil rights movement. We're talking about stories of the civil rights movement as if those are the credentials that demonstrate our commitment to racial and economic justice. And those examples are 50 years old. Those examples need to be refreshed. We actually must have current experiences that we are building right now that demonstrate loud and clear that our community cares about this issue and is in this issue for as long as it takes until we are in a society where Black lives truly matter. So I am just thrilled and honored to be moderating this conversation. I want to say a few quick words about how Bend the Arc and other Jewish organizations have been working on this issue, and then I'm going to introduce two and hopefully three soon of our panelists tonight. Bend the Arc has been active in the movement for Black lives in a couple of different significant ways. We've been part of direct actions throughout the country. We have used our voices in forums like this to talk about the issue in op-eds. We've been working on legislation, criminal justice and sentencing reform in particular. And we also, like a number of Jewish organizations, have been grappling with the reality that racism doesn't just happen out there, that racism is actually happening in the Jewish community and in our own organizations, including Bend the Arc. And so part of our commitment to tackling the movement for Black lives in an authentic and a way that we believe has integrity is to acknowledge the patterns of racism that exist in the Jewish community and outside of it, and to be committed to resolving both. We also don't do this work alone. There are so many other Jewish organizations that have done fantastic, amazing work, and I need to give a special shout out to Jews for Racial and Economic Justice, who are in the house right here, who really have been doing some of the best work in this city for the movement for Black lives. They're also having their 25th anniversary in 2 days. I'm gonna be at that party, I hope you are too. There are other organizations that have been working on this issue, Jews United for Justice in DC, Jews in All Hues in Philadelphia, Jewish Community Action in Minnesota, TRUA, Religious Action Center for Reform Judaism, Just Congregations, Jewish Alliance for Law and Social Action in Boston, and Uri Litzedek, and so many more. So with that, there are a lot of us doing this work, and there are a lot more that need to join in. So I'm gonna say a few words, and then I'm gonna turn it over to Opal and to David. So one is, in just like halfway through, you're gonna get some note cards, and we're gonna ask you to, if you have a question, for you to put your question on the note card, and then we'll be taking some questions at the end, the last 10 minutes. And I will now spend just a few minutes reading some short bios, and then I'm gonna turn it over to Opal and David. Hi. Yay! Perfect. See, we planned that. So, all right, so short bios, and then Yavilah, I just said that after the bios, I'm just gonna ask each of you to say one or two things about yourself that you wanna share as well.
Okay.
So, Opal Tometi is a co-founder of Black Lives Matter, a leaderful network that was launched in order to explicitly combat anti-Black racism and to protect and affirm the beauty and dignity of all Black lives. She currently serves as the executive director of the Black Alliance for Just Immigration, a national organization that educates and advocates to further immigrant rights and racial justice together with African American, Afro-Latino, African and Caribbean immigrant communities. Welcome, Opal. Thank you for joining us. We have Yavilah McCoy, the founder of Ayecha, one of the first nonprofit Jewish organizations to provide Jewish diversity education and advocacy for Jews of color in the United States. Yavilah is an educator and activist that has worked extensively within the multi-faith communities to increase racial justice and expand equity and inclusion. Yavilah currently serves as the CEO and Executive Director of Visions Incorporated, and I am so honored to count Yavilah as a Bend the Arc leader. Welcome, Yavilah. and my friend David Goodman. David is the president of the Andrew Goodman Foundation. The foundation is named after David's brother, Andrew, who was murdered during the Freedom Summer of 1964 by the Ku Klux Klan while pursuing voter registration for African Americans in Mississippi. Professionally, David is the principal of North Arrows LLC, and David's really wonderful wife, Sylvia, is in the audience. Sylvia is also the executive director of the foundation. So welcome, David. Hello, Sylvia. So why don't, I'd love to hear from each one of you just a couple things that will augment those bios, since those are the professional things on the paper. So how would you want the audience to know you in the context of this conversation tonight? And why don't you just arrive so you can take a deep breath if you want. And then I'll go to Opal, David, and then come back to you.
Well, first of all, thank you so much for all the work that you've done to get us to this point over having this conversation. I'm truly honored to be here and just to really build with this community. So just want to say thank you first off. A couple of things that can kind of situate who I am and how I come to this struggle. Well, one, I'm a person of faith. I'm a Black Christian woman, born and raised in Phoenix, Arizona, the daughter of Nigerian immigrants. And I really came of age in the desert, you know, of Phoenix. And one kind of key thing that I think folks should know is that much of my activism began over a decade ago. I was a community organizer in Arizona, coming of age in a time where the anti-immigrant movement was really robust, sadly, in Arizona. And the anti-immigrant movement was such that there were people, hundreds and hundreds of people, who were dying in the US-Mexico border region. And as a person of conscience, as a person who was the daughter of Nigerian immigrants, knowing the struggle to assert one's dignity, to make a living, to provide for one's family, I was really struck by how vocal the anti-immigrant movement was and how blatantly racist it was and how it was under this guise of immigration enforcement, but it was really racially coded, really deeply racially coded. It was really strategic in that it was pitting African American and immigrant communities against one another. And it was also fashioned in such a way that it was undermining the gains of the civil rights movement. And so I was greatly aware of this. I was also greatly aware of the human rights crisis that we were experiencing in Arizona. And so I quickly became active. I quickly became very vocal. I started organizing in my community. And, you know, fast forward almost 10 years later, I found myself living in Brooklyn, New York, faced with the news of Trayvon Martin's murder and his murderer, George Zimmerman's acquittal. And I am an older sister of two younger Black boys, one of whom is in high school still. And I remember hearing about the acquittal of George Zimmerman and just thinking to myself that this was going to be the story of his generation, that everyone all across the country knew this story, knew the trauma, experienced it firsthand, saw the court trial, saw the injustice, and George Zimmerman was essentially going to get off scot-free. And we knew that a guilty verdict wasn't going to be justice, right? Like, we knew that that wasn't the case. But some semblance of acknowledgement for the inhumanity, the depravity, the stalking and killing of a young Black boy, we didn't get that. And so he was on my mind the entire time. And so when I saw my sister Alicia Garza post on her Facebook wall one day a short note that ended with, "Our lives matter, Black lives matter," I quickly reached out, and I knew that I had to join with her and countless others across the country to raise this banner, to assert our human dignity, and to ensure that truly all lives and all Black lives would matter. So those are two key points for me. Yeah.
Thank you. Oh.
Thank you, Stosh, for inviting us, me, here. I was born and raised in New York City. I'm one of those people, I love New York. I'm a fourth generation civil engineer, and I'm from a contracting family. My great grandfather came from Russia after the Civil War. I didn't know him, but I knew he had 13 children. My grandfather was the only one who went to college, the only one of the 13. So they were all stone broke. That I knew. And I had the opportunity to know my great aunts and great uncles. And according to them, the reason their father, my great grandfather, came here was because Jews in Russia could be walking down the road and a Christian could come up to him and just stick a knife into their heart or slit their throats or hang them or set them on fire, and nothing ever happened to the Christians. And that was how the Jews were treated, a story that most everybody has heard about from their forefathers and mothers. And it never really meant much to me. Actually, I didn't necessarily believe it because most of my aunts and uncles died by the time I was 20. So at that point, I had read a lot. And when I was 17, my brother was murdered by the Ku Klux Klan with James Cheney and Michael Schwerner. And what I didn't appreciate when that happened, I was 17, my brother was 20, but it took me a while to figure this out, because my grandfather, who built the 8th Avenue subway and the Lincoln Tunnel and the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel, was fabulously wealthy, and we were from a very privileged family. And I had never, ever experienced anti-Semitism. I didn't know what went on in the world. Even though my parents were very progressive people politically, I didn't know that there was anybody in this country who would murder you because of an opinion. Maybe they'd yell at you or fight or spit at you, but to kill you, I just didn't know that. I didn't know that. But anyway, I found out, and over a period of time, I would say about 10 years, it dawned on me that the Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney story, which, by the way, was the first triple interracial lynching in the history of the United States, and the last. It was the first and the last. That because two white boys were murdered, right, by people who didn't care about Black lives, the rest of the majority of America was white. The Latino population was very small 50 years ago. The majority of the white population paid attention all of a sudden, because white lives mattered to white people. That has how I internalized this experience as a witness, as a family member. It had a tremendous impact on me. And my grandfather, who was just born stone broke like so many first generation Jews of immigrants, all immigrants actually, said to his 10 grandchildren, it was like you knew what Grandpa was going to say. America's a great country. This is the only place where somebody like myself could have gotten a job and become a multimillionaire and keep his money, and where the czar wouldn't come and chop your head off or take it from you, so on and so forth. But we never heard, or I never heard, I don't think any of my cousins heard about what went on in this country in the places we were not exposed to. So this happened. I was a witness to it in a way that I wouldn't volunteer for or suggest anyone volunteer for. But it had a tremendous impact on me and formulated how I saw the world thereafter.
Thank you, David.
So my name is Yavilah McCoy, and I'm from Boston, which I traveled heartily to get here to be with you. What's important to know about me is that I am a Black Jew. And what that means is that I am the product of a story that started long before me. My people started in the South, in the Deep South, and rose to a place of power within themselves and outside of themselves by making a choice. That choice involved being Jewish, and that choice also involved embracing justice. My grandfather was the vice president of AFL-CIO for the tri-state area. He did security for Dr. Martin Luther King, and he did all of these things as a proud Jewish Black man. What that meant was that in my home, and as I grew, I learned to take in Torah and to take in Jewish identity from a place of justice. That meant when I learned about Abraham and how he sojourned, we were told that he made a choice to leave a place of comfort, to go into a land that he had not yet seen, and do what was right. When I learned about people like Jacob and Moses and all these different people that were vibrant folks, they were, excuse my French, badasses. They were badasses, and they were the kind of people that we, as Black Jews, were to try to emulate with our vision and our understanding of justice. Now, fast forward, my parents didn't grow up in the South. My grandmother, when the Depression hit, had to leave the South and go up to support her sisters and brothers, a family of 10. A woman of 16 who dressed up like a man and painted ships and sent money back home down south to be able to support her family. That's what a woman was. I learned early on that being Jewish didn't mean that we don't see access, privilege, and power and its consequences. When we did move up north and when we did get to live in communities, we lived in Brownsville, Brooklyn, often right next door to white Jews. And some of those white Jews were my grandfather's comrades in arms in the Union. And some of them were moving out. And some of them were the only ones who would sell their houses to people who looked like us. And some of them left those ghettos and communities and never looked back. And we, as people of color, as Jews of color, stayed to tell that story. What's most important to know about me is that eventually my family ended up in Crown Heights, and that the Crown Heights riot started at the corner of my street, President Street. Gavin Cato was a little boy that my family knew. And when Gavin Cato was killed by a Lubavitch caravan, what we came home wondering was, could that have been my brother had he not had a skull cap on? Would he have been left in the street by Hatzalah, a Jewish ambulance? Questions for me started to come early on about what is the cost of access, privilege, and power? What happens as we move along the lines that were delineated by what? White supremacy. It's as simple as that, white supremacy. What are the costs of whiteness and Blackness in this country? I had to learn firsthand because we lived out an identity that was often different. So today I sit before you, I'm an Orthodox African-American Jewish woman, proud Black woman, but that's a journey. And it's a journey that started way before I even came into being.
So, Opal, I want to ask a question now about the movement for Black Lives and Black Lives Matter. I think many of us here are familiar with these words, mm-hmm. but I'd love to hear in your own words what you vision for this movement, how you experience this movement, what is this movement, how would you describe it, how would you want us to see it, feel it, know it?
All right. So big questions, or big question. I'll pick up on the latter, kind of the last way that you phrased that. And mind you, this is not the definitive answer. But what we are now experiencing and what we know this period to be, and the expression of all of these Black-led organizations that are taking courageous action all across the country, we're calling it the Movement for Black Lives, right? And the Movement for Black Lives isn't only comprised of Black people, but it's truly a multiracial, multi-ethnic, multi-faith movement under the banner of racial justice for Black people, right? And so this movement is actually part of a long, long history of preceding Black liberation movements. And we see ourselves as fighting for the human rights and dignity of all Black people. And so this really means that we look at the issues of our day from the vantage point of addressing the root causes, the necessity. What's very different about this period is that folks are explicitly talking about the ways in which anti-Black racism is embedded in the very fabric of this nation, and how this structural racism, right, and structural racism being the historic, the present conditions, the ways in which we're impacted every single day, is acutely impacting Black communities and leading to the types of brutality that we're seeing at the hands of law enforcement. But it's not just about that. We're concerned with the economic conditions of Black communities. We're concerned with the health disparities. We're concerned with our trans brothers and sisters who are being murdered. We're concerned with the high incarceration rates, right? We're concerned with the impact of the immigration enforcement system on Black immigrant communities. And so it's a very complicated and comprehensive movement that has to do with the quality of Black life. And we see that, and we know that historically, when Black life is truly valued and uplifted, that all people benefit from this. And so we're in the same tradition, fighting for the dignity, fighting for our rights, fighting for the joy, even, of all Black people. And we see this as a global movement. We're seeing people from South Africa to Germany to Brazil, folks standing up in solidarity, but also folks who are very rooted in the conditions and concerns of local Black communities. And that's, I think, what's most heartening about this movement, where we're saying it's not actually just about the communities here in New York, for example, or communities in particular locations. It's about all of our people showing up for the people where they are right now, right? You don't have to be doing this in solidarity with some community that you don't know about, but right here, right now, you can stand. And so the Movement for Black Lives is robust, it's thriving, it's comprised of many people from all walks of life who are heeding the call, who have rose to this banner, right, that Black Lives Matter. And they're not only rhetorically, you know, proclaiming this Black Lives Matter. I think what's most profound about this movement is that it's about the embodiment, right, the practice. So not just theory and just, you know, intellectually understanding the concerns of Black people, but it's about taking real action. And that, I think, is one of the most amazing things that we're seeing in this day and age, where people who are directly impacted are willing to risk, you know, arrest, willing to risk, you know, I'm getting death threats, and we're getting, you know, you have the trolls, you have the mail, you have all of that, but folks are willing to risk all of that. They're not being silent. They're speaking up about the issues of our day, and it's necessary. And, you know, that's in essence the movement, right? That's the movement. And I'll add that we have seen over the last few decades, like a divestment from the public safety net, if you will, from community resources, from the healthcare system, from, you know, programs that would provide jobs in low-income communities, and we've seen a concerted effort to invest in various apparatuses that criminalize us and criminalize our ability to even make a dignified living. And so we see that our movement is also standing up against this, right? Standing against the criminalization of blackness, right? The criminalization of who we are, the criminalization of our ability to move and to live. And we're calling for a radical investment, a reinvestment in our communities at every level. And so right now, we're calling for all of that in all of various ways. And you'll see we have various websites and different places where you can learn a little bit more about us and figure out a little bit more about the unique campaigns that comprise this movement. But that's what I'll say about that for now.
It's really incredible. I had the privilege of hearing Alicia speak last week, and she was speaking with Rashad Robinson, and they were talking about, she actually said, there are moments in time, I'm paraphrasing, there are moments in time when organizations and movements look out and they try and achieve what they believe is winnable. And there are moments in time when organizations and movement look out and try and achieve what is possible. And she said the movement for Black Lives is looking out and will achieve what is now impossible, which I thought was incredible.
That's right.
So Yavilah, I have a question for you. Of course, please jump on and elaborate on your take on the movement for Black Lives as a Black woman who's living it and in it. And I have an additional question for you too, which is, what do you think is at stake for the Jewish community in our ability to be with this movement? And what's at stake if we're not? Why must we be? If so, how should we be?
Loaded question. Big question, but I agree, big times. I think the first thing people should know in regard to what engages me about Black Lives Matter is this idea that my Black life matters. It matters both within the Jewish community and outside of it. And in all ways that Black lives have not mattered, there is an impact upon me and mine and all those that I love and care for in this universe. So my Black life matters to me, but all Black lives matter to me. And my hope is that my nation, that my orientation does not cause me to have to make a choice between that care for all Black lives and what it means to hold on to my Jewish identity. So that's something that's important to me in terms of Black Lives Matter. The other thing I need to say that I have been saying is that, you know, I have two teenage boys, and when my young teenage Black Jewish boys walk around in this world, I would like to know that coming back from synagogue in our neighborhood, our suburban neighborhood in Newton, doesn't become an opportunity for them to be profiled, for them to be in danger, for their value not to be seen. And this is something that differentiates my experience as a Jewish person from other Jews who don't always have to see that. And it's important to think about that every day if we are living a state of disequanimity in regard to how we even walk through life as Jews because of the color of our skin. In our not too distant history, Jews were not privileged by whiteness. In our not too distant history, it was Jews who were targeted for violence. It was Jews who were disenfranchised in Germany. It was Jews whose lives did not matter. That's not too far ago. Many people can go back two generations and find stories about Jewish life not mattering. Some people today can tell stories of Jewish life not mattering. What is the point of that? Is it to create a hierarchy of oppression where we compete with one another over who is more oppressed? Or is the point of that to I always say this to my kids as the lion, you know, Simba, the quote from Simba in Lion King, remember who you are, Simba, right? So something like that is the point for us to remember who we are in a way that has impact on this time and in this day as we face these choices. Now, what's at stake, I think, is our very soul, because there was a bartering. Racism is a form of negotiation. It's a transaction. You get something, you lose something. In order to have whiteness, many ethnicities in this country were asked to engage in a transaction. It said, ignore the tropes, ignore the mores of white supremacy. If we grant you whiteness, for the sake of us continuing white supremacy without it being interrupted. As a black Jew, noticing those choice points for my people as Jews have always brought me to activism. Why? Because I think if we don't make the right choices, we lose our very soul. And how do I know that soul? Because it's that soul that attracted my people to Judaism. It's that Jewish soul that is about justice. That Jewish soul that takes us all the way back to Mesopotamia and Rome, where the oldest form of racism was anti-Semitism itself. Where there was something in the body, in the blood, that said you cannot be valued. You can be targeted for death. That is old. And we have marched through so many countries and so many places in the world outliving hatred. Jews have outlived hatred by thousands of years. What will it do to our soul to forget that history? What will it do to us to engage in the practices and tropes of white supremacy in this country? What will it do to us? Whiteness and white supremacy has never been a friend of the Jewish community. And anybody who doesn't know that, I'm here to testify, it is not your friend.
Thank you. David, I want to go back to something that you brought up where you were talking about how you weren't actually aware of some of the stereotypes or some of the ways that people were discriminated against, Jewish or other. And in this moment where all of us are being called to action, ultimately, and all of us have different roles to play in that action, I've been thinking a lot about risk. And you having lived so intimately with the consequence of risk, with your brother's murder. And so I'm curious if you can share with us what you're thinking about in terms of risks, in particular the risks that white people and white Jews can consider taking in this moment. And what do you think about that? And what can we think about as we contemplate what risks we are thinking about and preparing to take?
Yeah, I mean, that word risk is very powerful for me. I spent my career working as a client of Wall Street. I was the chief executive officer of a company that bought other companies. And when you run a business, one of your responsibilities, a lot of business people are here, is to understand your risk profile in whatever you do. And I see risk as both a simple and a complex proposition. If you look at our country, 300 million plus people, not breaking it down, I will in a minute, into demographics, but across the board, our profile as a nation from the time I was a teenager, in all important metrics, have precipitously dropped education, attainment. We are now on the bottom of the totem pole of all the developed countries in the world in educational attainment. And at the bottom of the bottom are minorities. And at the bottom of the bottom of the minorities are poor minorities. Okay, so there's, when you go into the demographics, you can see a gradation and you can see the risk profile of what happens to people who are not educated or who can't get education. Now, this is fairly complex approach to your question of risk, but it's all related because as our educational attainment drops as a nation, our ability to compete globally drops. Our ability to maintain our economic position in aggregate drops. And the middle class in this country, and probably people are following this, as a matter of risk, are losing economic power across the board. So this started, as I view it, so I am interested in economics. I got my degree in business economics. If you look at where these problems started from, it started with the people lowest on the totem pole, which are poor minorities.
Totem pole is not a good word.
The what?
Totem pole.
True. The demographics economically across the board. And what we're seeing there is tremendous, in my opinion, risk profile that our country has subjected itself to. And we have to recognize that when you allow a small group to be at risk, we're all at risk. And I view that problem as a growing problem. Our health profile, same thing. All of these profiles, when you look at them, our health care is the most expensive of the developed countries, and we get the least for it. And again, when you go into the demographics and go and look at economic distribution, it's worse as you get into the lower income bracket. So this is a huge risk, and it's complicated, but it's also pretty obvious and simple. So what do we do about it? Well, for one thing, we have to be aware of it. And I don't think a lot of people really pay attention until something happens to them. So the Black Lives Matter concept is to point out to all of us, particularly the people who are unconscious, of which there are many of us, all of us in some ways, to pay attention, because it's a risk issue. And not to pay attention, we're putting ourselves at risk.
I'd like to take this moment and say, if you have questions for any of the panelists, then this would be a time that you have a note card and you should fill out your note card, and some people will be walking around collecting your questions and we'll be able to take a few of them at the end. So thanks for doing that if you have questions. Opal, I want to go back and ask you a question, a follow-up question on something you mentioned earlier, which is you mentioned your own faith tradition, and so I'm curious to know, what role do you see faith or faith communities having in this movement for Black Lives, if any? And then bonus question, if you have a thought, what role in particular do you think the Jewish community could play in the movement for Black Lives that would be additive and helpful to advancing this broad and comprehensive racial justice agenda?
Yeah. So I truly believe that faith communities, any tradition really, has a critical role to play in this movement. The reality is that the spiritual grounding that any kind of religious philosophy and tradition and or practice allows for us to come into this work and do it with the type of fervor, zeal, the knowledge that it's possible. So I love that you raised the Alicia's quote, right, about the impossible. But that's what faith traditions call us to, right? We are living the prophetic. We're calling it to existence now, right? And I believe that faith communities know that in their very DNA and are called to engage in that type of really transcendent lifestyle on this earth. And so I believe faith communities are a key cornerstone in our movement. And I find that there are people of all sorts of faiths that are part of our movement. You know, I was even leading a group of folks who were praying weekly about our movement and doing some other types of things and reading together and just kind of looking for just some support when it's really, really rough, right? So it's not easy work. It's not easy. We don't know exactly where all of our actions will lead. We have a vision, but you know, we're all in this grand experiment together. And it's really important that we have that type of grounding, for lack of a better term, that allows us to take that leap of faith and continue each day, step by step by step, trying to actualize our beliefs, our knowledge in the fact that we all belong, we are all worthy, and this world, this life is actually abundant. And this myth around scarcity and who really belongs here and is there enough for everybody and all the fighting and all the angst is not real, right? It's not real. It doesn't have to be so. It's real, right? It's happening, and so we see it, right? But it doesn't have to be so. And so I think faith traditions allow us to come back to the dignity that we're all endowed with. It allows us to live into the gifting that we all have. It reminds us of our shared humanity. And it reminds us that another world is truly possible, right? And so I really, 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 really appreciate all the faith communities that have come alongside our movements. There are many different spiritual leaders who've walked alongside us, who have been part of our strategy tables and so on, and have mobilized their, you know, their congregations, their mosques, their, you know, just various parishioners. And I think that it's just so critical for our movements. We need that type of that allyship, if you will. And then also that recognition that many of us have that background as well, right? So we might be, you know, Black Buddhists, Black Jews, Black, you know, all of us are part of this work too. And so I would say, in particularly for the Jewish community, I think this, right? Having these types of conversations, reminding one another of the legacy of you just spoke with such conviction about just the reality of, you know, your own experience and the reality that we can actually do this, and we need to see the Jewish community show up in ways that are a lot more visible, and really live into the call, really. And so I think these conversations, I think action, though, right? Beyond just the talk, we have to walk it out, right? And so in any way that folks can do that, I would say, let's do that. And I would follow the lead of Black Jewish people who have some ideas around this and who who live at these intersections, and I think probably have a lot more insight than myself, but I would say I follow my sister here. Whatever she says, like, let's do that. So, yeah, thank you. Great question.
So, Yavilah, please feel free to jump on that if you want to add. I had another question that I wanted to ask you too, so you can pick, choose. I know that in July you went to the Movement for Black Lives gathering in Cleveland, and I had just incredible conversations with you before and after. So I'm wondering if you can share with us what that was like and how it's impacted you up to this moment.
So one of the most wonderful things about going to the BLM convening in Cleveland was noticing myself in a room maybe double the size of this, and at once being completely Black and completely Jewish, and there being no questions that was just right. And the reason why that was true was because of the tone that leadership set. they said things from the front like, y'all need to love on each other hard. I hadn't heard that in Jewish space. I went in a contingent of Jewish leaders of color. I was not by myself. And so I sat in a row with maybe six other Jews of color. And when we turned to one another, and we were instructed by the, from the front by Alicia to tell the person to your right, I see you. And tell the person to your left, I see you. And look into their eyes and tell them, I see you. It brought up all sorts of things for me around where JOCs, which is the acronym that we use for Jews of color, are not seen. And how many spaces we navigate with our full power internally intact without being seen by our fellow Jews, where we are invisible. And I came back from BLM committed more than ever to being unapologetically Black and Jewish. That meant that I was willing to walk into spaces and take up space. Start telling people, no, the way this is being done, you can't see it, but this is about whiteness. I need this to be about people of color, because there are Jews who are people of color historically, presently, always have been, always will be, and we're here. So let's start making that true now. Things like that, you have to see some things sometimes to be able to take it in and know the impossible is possible. And I left the BLM convening knowing that people could make a difference right outside. As soon as we finished convening in that powerful way, there was a young boy who police targeted immediately because he had a Snapple bottle in a paper bag. And they tried to take that boy away. And what happened was, all of the people of color in the LC went out into the street and surrounded the police car, and essentially wouldn't let them take him away. You know what happened at the end of that story? The police left. They left 1,500 people of color to keep doing their business. And you know what? That taught me something. When we show up, all of us, together, saying justice, the institutional paradigm of racism has no choice but to retreat. I want that to be true in my Jewish community. I want to count on all of us to show up, do what we need to do, and know that the evil that is white supremacy and racism must falter and flee in our wake. Now, I'm gonna say one more thing, which is this. You know, Nietzsche, he says that all things that are alive are constantly being reinterpreted, transformed, and redirected. If we understand that to be true, we must understand we are not talking about the cross burnings, the racism of the 60s right now. There's something called modern racism that we're up against. And modern racism is also, like I said, a transactional exchange. And that transactional exchange involves individual and institutional choices. We are making choices about contact. We're making choices about being in proximity and lack of proximity to each other's stories. The thing that I need is for us to get in closer proximity to what it means to have a Black life as a Jew. I want you to know intimately what it means to walk the world as a Black Jew, and I want that to become a part of every Jew's story. I want all Jews to know that JOCs are beautiful, powerful, smart, intelligent, capable, and should be the presidents of the Federation, of the URJ, of every Jewish institution that you can find as representatives of the Jewish people, and not because they have funny stories to tell. Because we are a multiracial people. And the only way that paradigm is going to shift is for us to say, let the people of color lead. Give them all they need to be powerful. Don't make them invisible. make them visible and central and a part of everything we do as Jewish, because the choice we made, that can be a reverse transaction. Just like you put a little ATM thing and, you know, you make a transaction with a credit card. We made some transactions. I want every single transaction that we've made as a Jewish people that is in support of white supremacy and racism to be reversed, whether we knew it, whether we didn't know it, whether we did it willingly, whether we did it unwillingly. I want our attention on reversing that transaction. And to me, that would mean making Black Jewish lives matter.
David, I have a question, building a little off of what Yavilah just talked about in terms of modern racism, and knowing that, I don't know your exact age.
107
years old. So I don't remember how old whatever. We are from different generations.
You're 29.
And we love each other.
Yeah, you're 29.
I'm not 29, but in any event, in this current context, I'm curious, from your vantage point, what do you see as the bright spots in this racial justice movement, in this moment of civil rights that is unfolding, that did not exist when you were younger and when you were having your own family's experience? What feels different? What feels, it could be challenges too, but also what do you see that actually is giving you hope? You run a foundation that is helping to ensure that all Americans have the right to vote, which right now, let's all be clear, we do not all have the right to vote. And your work day in and day out is to ensure that all people are enfranchised. So what is it about this moment that gives you the inspiration and hope to continue to do your work and to do your part?
Well, that's really a great question, and what you said is very powerful in my heart and mind. And what we're doing in the Andrew Goodman Foundation is a risk mitigation, okay, to pick up on that word. My wife, Sylvia, is an educator, a tenured teacher, and corporate executive coach, and has a lot of the skills and training. So she has put together a program called Vote Everywhere. And we are a national platform and with a national infrastructure that enters into partnerships with colleges and looks for the next and finds the next generation that are interested in this word, F-A-I-R, fair. They have to have a proclivity and a demonstrated interest in that which is fair. You can call it justice or against injustice. And I am very encouraged with what I'm seeing. All the studies that I read, like the Pew Charitable Trust, do studies on what's exciting young people today. And this word, fair, keeps coming up. Marriage equality for the millennial generation is, it's not even an issue for most of them. You know, we think of it, or my generation thinks of it as, oh, I gotta think about this. They don't think about it because it's just fair that someone should be able to marry who they love, period. So as a risk matter, we believe that you have to create platforms for this generation to find their voice, amplify it, put together coalitions, which is your work and your work and your work, our work, because we can't do this alone. Martin Luther King is viewed as a great leader, but a little lady by the name of Rosa Parks created a platform, unwittingly perhaps, or not actually unwittingly, and he became famous, but it was a huge coalition. There were thousands of people who made the Montgomery bus boycott successful. And by the way, it was heavily invested in by white Caucasian Jewish people from New York, because that's where King got his money, through Harry Belafonte. He came to the progressive Jewish community in New York City, who funded that. So he knew how to build coalitions, and in our Vote Everywhere program, one of the things we actually train to, it's an experiential program, it's not scholastic. They have to go out, find something they're interested in, and then create coalitions and learn how to organize and make all the mistakes that you're gonna make when you learn. And one of our, and we call them ambassadors, one of our ambassadors was instrumental in getting the student body, the NAACP at the University of Mississippi, last 2 weeks ago to take down the state flag, which has the image of the Confederate flag of the Army in its corner. And the faculty voted, and they got the faculty vote. And he, in other words, he created a coalition, learned the lessons that we're teaching in the foundation across the country. So as a risk manager, and consistent with what you're saying, go out there and do it, but don't talk about it, do it. This is the story of Andy Goodman. He was an ordinary kid who did something extraordinary, along with thousands of others. He wasn't by himself. He didn't sit in the corner with a poster or a placard on. He was one of a thousand, literally. There were a thousand kids, young adults, who organized and created coalitions, amplified their voice, and spoke truth to power. He lost his life, but we don't focus on that part. We focus on what he was a part of, which is what we're doing. And it's really, really important to think about the risk of not doing this.
Are there questions from the audience? Okay, this is a question for Yavilah. It says, do you find that there is a disconnect between ideas of chesed or loving kindness and activism in the religious community? How has your activism been met? You can look at that too if you want. Sometimes it helps me to read it too.
Yeah, it's very interesting. I'm on a journey in regard to my recalibrating what I understand Torah to be most impactfully used toward in my life. And I'll say a little bit more about what that means. It means that there's something sometimes that happens in Orthodox communities that's called groupthink, where we're told what something means, and then we all are trying to replicate that thing in some way alongside norms that have been established for what that thing is, and either you're doing it right or you're doing it wrong. Now, chesed, the word chesed, had a very specific, that means kindness in Hebrew, but chesed had a very specific connotation when I was coming up in a Hasidic community. Chesed was what we did for other people. Chesed was when we went out and took care of the sick. Chesed was when we had a chesed project and we did extra babysitting for someone. Chesed was multiple acts that we did for others. As I get older as a Jew, I am and notice myself as a black woman, the deepest kindness I can offer is to notice myself. Not notice myself from a place of self-infatuation, but to notice myself as in what's in me that needs to come out of me as a kindness to the world. That's chesed. That's what God did in creating the world. And that's what I was taught too, but I didn't focus on that piece. They said that the world came into being as an act of chesed. God went into himself or herself or itself and came back outward to create the world. And everything you see is a manifestation of that kindness. So the world is shaped by kindness, I was taught, right? So what I'm trying to think about when it says, is there a disconnect? I think the biggest disconnect is not being introspective enough about what our tradition has to teach us that is not just for ourselves, but also to come out of ourselves to the broader world. There are beautiful things in a people that worships a God that they cannot see. We were one of the only people in Mesopotamia to worship a God that was not a graven image. We worshiped with an empty box. I'm talking about the Aron, right, that held the tablets. There was no God in there. The God was an empty box. It says that we are supposed to fill that space. So chesed is about filling space, but filling a space not by being stuck on our own navels or to the things that only mean things to us, but growing outward to the things that mean something to everyone, that we were put on this world to be able to make a difference. And that's how I understand chesed.
So this question says, what's up with All Lives Matter? who wants to take that one?
I'll take that.
Okay.
Quite briefly.
I'm sure what's you have not been all? Asked that before.
Well, not quite like that. So I'll just say one thing straight up, and that is, Black Lives Matter is in fact us saying that all lives matter, right? It's to say that unless Black Lives Matter, we aren't actually living in a world in which all lives matter. And there are particular realities that make it such that we know that we're living in a day and age where every 28 hours an unarmed Black person is killed by a security guard, a police officer, or a vigilante. And this is a reality. And so when we say Black Lives Matter, is to assert that we need to make it such that that never happens again, right? Never, ever happens again. And this move to say All Lives Matter, or so many other renditions of Black Lives Matter, where black is actually taken out of the phrase, is in essence to silence us from speaking the truth, from naming what's actually taking place. And you know, I see this, and you know, my other comrades in the struggle also see this as a grievous error and an injustice to silence us, in essence. We have to, in fact, name what's taking place in order for us to address it, right? And I think sayings like All Lives Matter and others have to do with folks who might be scared of, you know, addressing the issues of our day, scared of addressing the ways in which they may be complicit in the ways in which we're abused, disenfranchised, devalued, and so on. And so, you know, I encourage us, whenever we hear those other types of phrases, to really interrogate why that's happening, why that's occurring, and challenge folks to stand alongside Black communities in raising the banner and saying Black Lives Matter, and also fighting to ensure that Black lives truly matter.
Thank you. So we have time for one more question, even though I have a stack, but we're just not gonna have time tonight. So I'm gonna do my best to read this one through. So, from research I've done on Dr. King, he emphasized the importance of Black people who are fighting for their right to be polite, well-dressed, kind, even to those who oppress them. My Jewish parents and grandparents emphasized the same to me, in essence, to adopt the norms of the majority society in power. Is there room for this legacy to be incorporated into the current efforts for justice in Black lives? Which one of you would like to answer that? And this will be the last one.
Is that a question? I don't understand the question.
I think if I'm paraphrasing, but my sense is that there is a question about Right now, we hear so much around respectability and the fact that there are moments in this movement that are making some people feel profoundly uncomfortable. And so my sense is that this person is interested in wondering, what is the connection, if any, between an older sentiment that one needed to be polite in the process of making social change in this current moment that we're in? Is there a place for it? If so, where? If not, I just embellished on whosoever question that was, so I hope I did that justice.
I just want to say that Dr. King also taught that if there was an injustice in the world that needed interrupting, that the most polite thing we could do on behalf of society was to interrupt that oppression. That interruption is not being rude. That interruption is a deep expression of caring. It could be that we don't know how to listen in multiple languages. And it may be that we are a diverse people as a humankind. And so people speak in different languages and we have to learn how to listen differently in order to be able to hear them. One thing I'm noticing, at least in working with a lot of young people of color now, is that they are impatient with this idea of respectability because respectability has not caused their friends to stop dying in the streets. Respectability in all these years has not brought an end to white supremacy. So yes, maybe we have to figure out how to interrupt white supremacy and racism elegantly and how to say no when that is a norm that permeates our institutions with grace. And maybe we have to dress in a way that says that we are beautiful and help you to see that. But that definition of beauty has to come from within. No one gets to decide for another person how their expression of beauty should manifest in the world. So I don't know about that whole respectability thing. Respectable to whom is what I would probably say.
I will just echo and ashe and amen to everything you just said, sister. All that I would add to that is that these acts that we're seeing, so the disruptions, you know, the stopping of traffic or subways and things like that across the country, is an effort to make very visible the contradiction of our nation's values, right? Will we respect property more than we respect the lives of people? And the courageous acts of my brothers and sisters across the country really is to ask the question of which side in history will you stand on? Will you stand with people who are championing and defending the rights of humanity? Or will you stand with the oppressors? Will you stand with white supremacy? Will you stand along a legacy of structural racism? And so that's, in essence, what these questions around our tactics, our strategies, they're very diverse, very, very diverse strategies that are being employed at this time. But those that are most visible and maybe make people uncomfortable are probably the types of actions that we really need to see more and more of, because it begs the question for all of our society as to, where will you stand? Will you join in this struggle with us? The reality is we can't do this on our own, right? We need each other in this struggle. And so it's more of an invitation. I see these actions, and it's not about, you know, is somebody's pants being pulled, you know, up on their waist? Do they have a belt? Are they saggy pants? Are they interrupting a presidential candidate? There are all these various ways in which respectability plays out. And we're essentially saying as a movement, it's enough of that, enough. You know, we can't sit idly by while people are being killed day in and day out. So,
yeah. Yeah, this concept of respectability is mind-boggling. Someone was saying to me 2 or 3 weeks ago, things have changed because if you want to vote now, you won't get shot like your brother was or murdered. And I said, oh, well, the way we murder people now respectfully is you have health care that's available in every state, but you don't choose to let people have health care, which is federal law because you're a governor of a state, so you respectfully cause a couple hundred thousand to drop dead a year, a couple hundred thousand for not having health insurance. That's respectable. Nobody yells, nobody screams. They just get together and no health care. But I don't hear that brought up. I hear the respectable on the other flip side of that. Oh, well, someone's yelling, somebody's screaming. I mean, we need to have a revisioning of what's going on in this country. Alabama, a couple of years ago, passed a law, and by the way, Illinois was the first, not just southern states, that you had to have a photo ID to vote. Most states, until 5 years ago, didn't require that. And then 2 months ago, in the 10 blackest counties in Alabama, they shut down all the Department of Voter Vehicles where you get your photo ID. Shut them down, eliminated them. Nice and respectable, no one yelled, no one screamed, they just passed the law. Hello? Respectable. This is America. Understanding the risks we're taking with what we do.
I'm just remembering this because I believe that there's a fabric of oppression and that if you can't understand something in one silo of oppression, step to what? To the right, step to the left, you'll see it as a woman, as a queer person, as a person who is non-Christian, right? So I'm remembering when it was said that well-behaved women accomplished nothing, right? And I'm noticing ways in which speaking out and loudly as women was not respectable, that we had to behave ourselves. And it was only when we stopped behaving ourselves as women that we were finally able to get rights in this country, because we were only being told to behave in order to keep our oppression in place. So if we can understand it there from a place of feminism, step to the right. Let's understand that from a place of youth. Step to the left. Let's understand that from a place of being black. Step upward and understand that from the place that it was very respectable to oppress Jews in Germany. You see the pictures of bunches of crowds standing around, respectably watching, as a Gestapo officer cuts off the side locks and beard of a Jew. And people are standing there looking quite respectable. How did it feel when everyone was so concerned with being respectable that our rights became trampled upon? There is a time and place to be respectable, and there is a time and place not. And we have to know the difference.
So that's a great sentiment to end tonight's conversation on. I want to thank you, Yavilah, Opal, David. Thank you so much for having this conversation together and with us. Thank you, Dr. Levy and Erica Resnick, for organizing this in the Skirball Center. I want to say two quick calls to action for all of you. One is an announcement that Bend the Arc now has a New York City chapter. And so for any of you who are interested in being active in us, in our work, please do join us. Rachel Ackoff, where are you? Rachel is our organizer here, so please reach out to Rachel and let her know if you'd want to connect with us on that. We'd love to see you. And then second, I want to announce that tomorrow there's going to be a large, large national day of action for the Fight for 15. So this is the Fight for $15 minimum wage. People across the country are going to be standing up with fast food workers, childcare workers, and all 64 million underpaid workers making less than $15 an hour, because it's time that we all make at least $15 an hour. And we are going to be with a Jewish contingent. There is something happening really early in the morning, 6 in the morning. There are going to be a number of Jews and a klezmer band. Then also at 10:15 tomorrow, we're joining up at 124th Street and Adam Clayton Powell in Harlem. And the action that's tomorrow at 10:15 is very much connected to tonight. The action will focus on the connection between Black Lives Matter and the fight for 15. And it's often, of course, the same people who are both underpaid and then incarcerated, or incarcerated and then underpaid. So we have flyers. If you're interested, please join us. Please join in. Please join all of us making the impossible possible. And I just want to echo what Yavilah said, that this is truly a moment, I believe, that the soul of the Jewish community is going to be measured by the degree we either participate powerfully and appropriately in this racial justice movement or not. And so it really is time. And the opportunity is huge. So thank you for coming tonight. We look so forward to connecting with you, and have a safe voyage home.